Welcome to Safari Live to the beautiful Juma Private Game Reserve. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have VM the Wildebeest Dawnbunk on camera, and we have a hornbill calling behind us. And Jamie and Dangerous Dave are out in the other vehicle, and we have Rebecca Knight. But we are now heading back up towards where we were hoping Karula's tracks would come out. There were just too many elephants to go walk in there today. So maybe she's made her way towards the treehouse waterhole. Only time will tell. So we're going to have a quick look here, and then we're probably going to get on the long road down to Cheetah Plains and see what we can find down there. So as I said, we are in Juma, a private game reserve, which is in the... Very excited to be able to explore this wonderful wilderness with all of you out there. So we're hoping to find tracks of Karula, our dominant female leopard, who's got two cubs of around 4 months old. And our last tracks we had from her up on that crest over there, and her general direction was coming through here. So I'm hoping that she's crossed this nice big sandy road where those pug marks will be prominent and easy to see and give us a good chance at finding her. There's a couple of prominent elephant paths that come through this area. What was that? I think it was a kudu or water buck that crossed the road up ahead. We'll have a look when we get a bit closer. So there is a spot. I had a chat to Taxon, who's the guide from Juma out of the commercial lodge here at Vuyatela, and he let me know there is a spot that Karula likes to leave her cubs at coming up ahead. I've actually seen her there with a kill twice before. And it's a beautiful big old milkberry tree on top of a termite mound. So we will have a look there as well. And it is waterbuck crossing up ahead. So I'm going to see if we can get a bit closer to them. If you're wondering about any of the animals out here, .tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So this waterbuck crossed here. It might not be the most obliging. It looked like they were on a mission somewhere. All I saw, I think they've moved off into the thickets. Standing by. I'm busy using the game drive radio that lets us communicate with the other vehicles. And that enables us to move around, and if anyone finds anything, we can communicate with each other and give us all the best chance of seeing the best sightings possible. I haven't checked there yet. You're more than welcome to. So that's Jamie, and she's going to go check on the other side of this area where we think Karula is. And of course, being out in the bush, we could be completely wrong, and she could have done an oop-de-loop and completely confuzzed us. While we have a squiz around here, let's go across to Jamie so she can say a good afternoon.
Good afternoon and welcome to our portion of the sunset safari. There's a very strange noise coming from behind me. I'm not quite sure what's going on. Dave, what is going on? Oh, it's just a wire that came undone. Okay, so we won't concern ourselves with that in any way, shape or form. And on that off to an auspicious start, beginning, my name is Jamie and I have Dave on camera with me this afternoon. And we are heading out to help with the search for the Queen of Juma. We're going to head through to where she had her kill Oh, no, we're not. We're going to stop here and say hello to the little warthogs. Just back up slightly. Oh, I wonder, is this the same group that has been hanging around here for the last few months? Yes, that looks right. Four little ones and two sows. It started out as six tiny babies months ago when they were absolutely minuscule. The nice thing about this little family group is that they are wonderfully relaxed around vehicles. It's only in the last sort of, I would say, 6 months that we've really been able to enjoy sightings with the warthogs in this area. They were quite skittish when I first started working here. Now, there were six little piglets. One was eaten by Tingana a few months ago, not too far away from where we are now. Tingana is the big dominant male leopard in this area, and he has something of a preference, or at least a talent, for hunting burrowing animals, from what we can tell, particularly warthog. We've seen him with warthog on several different occasions. As for what happened to the sixth, I have absolutely no idea, although I suspect that Tingana may well have been involved as well. Nice to see them back once again. When we first saw them, I think it was four of the piglets belonged to one sow and two belonged to the other. Very common with warthogs, they form little sounders. Very often it's a mother and her grown-up daughter and their piglets, but it can be unrelated females as well. And although you didn't get to see him, there was also a very big boar, a male warthog, wandering about the back, but he ran as soon as we stopped to have a look at them. We've just come out of warthog rutting season. So they have a set breeding period here, in the same way the impala and the wildebeest do. They've trotted off. Unfortunately, there's a bit of a short warthog sighting. They've moved right off into relatively thick bushes. We'll leave them be and carry on towards the site of that female leopard's impala kill. Now, Nock, who is a new viewer, welcome to the Sunset Safari. Nock would like to know how long this goes on for. Well, I have wonderful news for you, Nock. We go live twice a day, every day, for 3 hours, which means that for us, we have been starting recently at 6 in the morning Central African time and then going on until 9 in the morning Central African time. Then we head out in the afternoon at 3 o'clock in the afternoon Central African time and on to 6 o'clock Central African time. However, Nock, and for all of our other viewers out there, on the 1st of June, given our current headlong plunge into winter, we will be shifting the morning sunrise safari half an hour later in order to afford us with a little bit more light, first of all, and also so that the staff of Wild Earth don't freeze to death at some point, which nearly happened this morning. Jandre and myself shivered our way through the sunrise safari. It's very chilly out here at the moment, or but I feel like it's very chilly. And if you do have any more questions about that or any more concerns, you can have a look at our blog on the Safari Live Facebook page. That will give you a bit more in the way of information about that. But it will just be the Sunrise Safari, and it is just a half an hour later shift. Unfortunately, I know that for some of you, we're a very rigid schedule in terms of our days and nights here, given that we're up with sunrise and working until past sunset. And then for those of you on the western coast, 9:30 p.m. until half past midnight. So Nock, I'm not quite sure where in the world you are from. Please do let us know. It's nice to know where different people are watching from. We have viewers from Japan, we have viewers from New Zealand. We have a lot of viewers from the States, just all over. Every corner of the globe should be filled with our viewers, hopefully, in the future, and we can bring awareness of this incredible wilderness area that we are in. Speaking of which, I've never been to this kill site. Dave, have you been to this kill site? You have been to this kill site. That's very good news. I know roughly where it is. I don't know exactly where it is. Am I going to go left or right here? Yeah. I'm going to go left. Perfect. Thank you very much. Aren't we lucky to have such wonderful cameramen who not only do fantastic camera work, but also sometimes help us with directions. Most useful. Okay, well, at least the clouds from this morning have cleared away. It feels like a little bit of a brighter afternoon. I'm sure the animals are enjoying the reprieve from the chilly temperatures. Okay, now unless I'm not very much mistaken, it is somewhere just ahead of us. I was going to chat to Brent quickly, see how his search is going, because I know that he's also been looking for tracks of Karula. Standing by.
Jamie, I've checked for them all the way through to Garden, and there's no sign of any tracks crossing. Might be worth checking Zoe's Rebecca's area after you check the last position of that near one. I'm going to start making my way.
Copy that. Thanks, Brent. Brent just letting me know he's been looking for different tracks. Are we going in here, Dave?
I think it's a little bit further on.
A little bit further on. Why are there so many vehicle tracks here? That's interesting. Sometimes when you are looking for a sighting, one of the easiest ways to find it is to just follow where...
It is along here.
Okay, perfect. Follow where all of the vehicles have gone before you. Perfect. Thank you. She was spotted yesterday afternoon. She was actually, her kill was found yesterday morning on the Sunrise Safari by Taxon and Aubrey. At which point, there was a bit of a stakeout conducted. Brent found her resting here in the afternoon. Now, apparently she did have her cubs with her. However, unfortunately, they didn't come out whilst Brent spent a bit of time with her. Speaking of Brent, he wants to chat again. He might have picked up on some tracks of her. Standing by.
Hey, Jamie, from the weeping wattle where you'll find fur and stuff that your was on the ground, if you head south, you should see my tracks and drag marks going south. There's also lion tracks going south. It's in a very weird tree. It's sort of a broken marula that's pointing to the west. And the leg is hanging in the bush below it.
Copy that, thanks. I've got the marula tree. I'll see if I can find whatever's left. Okay, let's just keep our eyes peeled. We're going to go nice and slowly. Brent helping me out with directions to where he somehow magically managed to find where Karula had hidden a portion of her kill. Apparently, what happened last night is the hyenas stole most of it, and then a male lion came wandering through this area, and we think that Karula, with her cubs, decided that this was really not going her way, and that perhaps it was time to move out. There's the leg. Hanging from, you got it there, Dave. Thank you. Here's the leg. Very, very little meat left. Not really enough to encourage her to return here. And I suspect that looks like a bizarre place for her to have hoisted her kill. I suspect she was trying for a little bit higher up on the marula tree that was above it, and that unfortunately she just didn't quite manage it. But I can't imagine how she would have managed to get that up there otherwise. While we're here, I'm just making 100% sure that she isn't hidden somewhere in the bushes, in the shade, perhaps. A leopard has the most extraordinary camouflage. She could well be just resting quite contently in the shade. I don't think so. I'm going to concentrate a little bit harder, make extra specially sure that she hasn't come back here. In the meantime, let's find out what Brent's plans are for the rest of his afternoon.
So, Jamie's made her way back to that last position of Karula's kill. Now, there's very little meat left, but there is always that chance that the leopards might come back to that spot. VM and I have decided we feel like seeing a different spotted cat today, since we're heading out to those vast open areas of cheetah plains, and we're hoping we are going to be able to find the cheetah. But before we get down there, there's always something to look at, and one of the cutest little antelopes in the African bush is a baby waterbuck. They are just so fluffy. There we go there. Not being very obliging today, heading off. Oh, there's one in the road, Jim. An adult waterbuck. So some of the animal species we have out here have a very set breeding season. Those in particular will be impala, wildebeest and warthog. The rest of the antelope and animals out here will breed pretty much at any time of the year. No, with no specific season. So that's why we do see baby waterbuck, baby kudu, baby inyala, baby bushbuck throughout the year. This drongo is having an argument, as we can hear them dive bombing each other. And it wasn't that long, it was a while ago where James and I witnessed an incredible drongo fight where they nearly killed each other. Or went nearly killed the other one. Oh, it looks like it's over. It's seen off the other drongo, and it has claimed victory. So we're busy, we're heading on the southern boundary of our traverse, and we're gonna head due east down to Cheetah Plains. So it's gonna take us probably about 10 minutes or so to get there. But we're always checking, as I said, we're about to go through the Mawati River, which is a little dry river, or dry creek, that cuts through the heart of Juma. So if any of you watch the Waterhole Cam, that is on the Mawati River, that dam, that depression in front. But lower down, it becomes a bit wider and a bit more sandy, and we are able to drive in it. We're not going to drive in it today. I don't think there's too much happening around there. Here we go. We're just going to cross through the dip of the Mawati River. Now, we spend a lot of time in and around the banks of the Mawati. Lovely big trees attract leopards, as well as a whole host of other animals and glorious birds as well. Hello, a Cathy, who's a new Durham Cathy, is wondering about one of the more interesting little bird species we get out here, the oxpecker. Now, the oxpeckers feed off ticks and other ectoparasites that occur on the medium to large-sized mammals. And Cathy's wondering, when they feed their young, do they regurgitate up for them? They don't, Cathy. They'll feed their young live ticks that they've plucked from an animal, so they don't regurgitate. You're just checking for tracks there, but they don't regurgitate. They will feed them live ticks or fleas or other parasites. They might preen off the medium to large mammals out here. I think tonight's going to be particularly chilly. I'm starting to regret my choice of attire for this sunset safari. Oh, hello to you too. A little elephant bull, or not so little, teenaged elephant bull, giving us a trumpet, letting us know he's there. Hello, mister. Sorry we were ignoring you. A nice little trumpet just to let us know he's around. You can see how he's pointing at his trunk towards us. He's giving us a smell. Now, their sense of smell is obviously incredible, as is their sense of hearing. Eyesight is often thought to be quite weak, but it's not too bad, but it's definitely not as good as their other senses. So you can just see two young elephant bulls. The other's obscured by the bush. And they might be trailing a breeding herd. Unfortunately, they are outside of our traverse area, and they look to be heading deeper in to our neighbor. So even though we can't cross boundaries, the animals can. So we're part of about a 13 million acre unfenced system where the animals can meander wherever they choose. Emil, who was a first-time Safari Live goer this morning, welcome again to the back of our safari vehicles, Emil. Emil would like to know, do we also do these drives during the rainy season? And yes, we do, Emil. So what we call the rainy season, we do get, depending on the year, a fair bit of rain, but nothing too hectic. We're on a sort of, not arid, but dryish part of South Africa. We get on average around 450 millimeters of rain a year, and generally in big thunderstorms. So it's not raining all the time. So we do the rides during the rainy season as well. And it gives us a chance to see a whole host of different creatures and another completely different side to the bush. We've got a lot of beautiful migratory birds that come through, lots of insects and butterflies and moths and caterpillars and all sorts of creepy crawly creatures that are just as wonderful as all the big hairies and scaries. Hi, Rick. Rick's in North Carolina, and Rick would like to know, how cold is it going to get during our winter months? Like, the coldest I've ever experienced in the Sabi Sands was probably about 10 years ago, maybe even a bit longer, and that was about -1. I've seen frost once, -1 centigrade, so around zero, so 30 Fahrenheit, but on average a really cold day for us out here is about in the morning, early morning, 6 or 7 degrees Celsius, and warming up to around 20, 25 degrees Celsius during the day. Oh, more elephants up ahead. They are again crossing across the edge of our traverse, but let's try and get a nice view of them. Look like a really sweet little baby there. Hello, Elise. There's a breeding herd here. Oh, look at it. She's deciding not to use her trunk. She's just chewing on the old branch. Hi, Jessie. Jessie would like to know about an elephant's breeding cycle. Well, like the waterbuck that we saw a bit earlier, elephants aren't set to a particular breeding cycle. They can breed at any time of the year. What's interesting about elephant breeding is that for them to breed, the male has to be in a heightened hormonal state called must, and it's spelled M-U-S-T-H, and the female has to be an estrus. Now, look at this. This is just so cute. Being a bit lazy, munching on that little marula tree. Now, let's just have a look what she's going to do there. Oh, here we go. Look at using the tusk as well as a lever to break that branch or get it down to a height she can chew on it.
Like a dog on a bone.
Yes, there we go. As VM says, like a dog on a bone. Now, elephants can be very playful. Even though she is feeding, this could be quite just a bit of playfulness and while she is feeding. And they have to feed constantly. Jesse, I'll get back to their breeding cycle shortly. And while she's doing something quite interesting, let's just watch a little bit more carefully and chat about that. Oh, now she's stopped. So as I was saying, Jesse, so what happens is that the big dominant bulls, the biggest, strongest elephant bulls, coincide their must cycles with the time when the most females are in estrus. Now that just depends where you are in Africa. It can be very varied, so there's no one set answer. Quickly across to Jamie, who's got a bird we've never seen before.
There's a really cool bird behind that tree, and I'm really hoping that it's going to be visible in a moment. Let's try. Oh, hold on, here he comes. We're gonna get lucky. Unlike most of our feathered friends that tend to run to fly away from camera, this one is running away. And fly, trying to fly up my nose. A red crested corhawn. One of the birds that we hear very often, but we hardly ever get to see. And from what I can see, we've got a male here. Ooh, even stopped to have a quick snack. Can't see what it caught there, some kind of grasshopper maybe, or a caterpillar, rejected, whatever it was. It's got the black belly. Well, a black-bellied bustard has, and yes, it's definitely a male. See that grey crest on the top of the head? The female lacks that completely. A red-crested corhawn. Lost track of where he is in real life, as opposed to on the monitor. Oh, there he is. I think he's going to stay relatively well hidden. I just wanted to point out what identifies a red-crested corhawn from the other species that is very, very closely related and that we see frequently, and that is the black-bellied bustard. And the black-bellied bustard is quite a bit larger than the red-crested corhawn, but that doesn't help you very much if you're looking on your screens, because a sense of scale can be exceptionally tricky to get. Ah, oh, there he's showing you that grey cap beautifully, and underneath that is a ring of bright red feathers that gives the red-crested corhawn his name. But in the male black-bellied bustard, that black belly actually extends all the way up the throat and to underneath the chin, whereas in the red-crested corhawn it is just up to their chest. There is a very persistent fly that is now attempting, every time I try and swish it away, it returns once again, go away. It's really, really determined. Right, our lovely bird has disappeared, so back to Brent and his much larger animals.
Well, sorry about that. I got a bit of misinformation there. I thought they said Gory bastard. Oh, look at that one, seeing off another one of the game drive vehicles. So, as you can see, we're on the top of a ridge here. Down there is a little river system called the Mulwanini. So basically the small Mwati. We've crossed the Mwati River already. And that's the Mulwanini down there. And the elephants are holding us up a little, causing a little traffic jam, but they are just too sweet. There's that little one picking up a broken marula branch now. The rest of the breeding herd seem to be a little bit further away. Right, once they give us a chance, we're going to go cross through this little river system, and we're probably going to lose signal on our way to Cheetah Plains. Unfortunately, we are going to have to move. We're causing quite the traffic jam with the elephants. We're just going to idle past them. Just go around the long way. Oh dear, we've got a bit of a... Oh, diff lock in. Probably gonna leave.
As Brent starts to head across to Cheetah Plains, there will be patches in which his signal does disappear. You back on Wendy and off to help me in my search for Karula. You never know. There's always the possibility of spotting her before I do. There's certainly a possibility that Dave will spot her before I do, because Dave sits a little bit higher, and therefore, from your perspective, so do you. It means that you can keep your eyes peeled, see if we can't spot her from somewhere here. It'll be very tricky. I do understand that. It has happened once, or not quite, but it almost happened once, where I drove underneath shadow. I didn't realize she was sitting right above me on a termite mound. And Brian had a good chuckle at me and then just casually turned the camera onto her without pointing her out to me first. It does occasionally occur. Alright, let us see if we can't figure out where she is. I think she's just found a nice shady spot. Aha! That is incredible. And she's actually gone up and down here. Okay, sorry, I'm looking at her tracks and I'm going to find you a really nice position to look at them. Brent found these tracks very clearly this morning, judging by where he has circled them. Try and get a slightly clearer view, and the reason I want to do that is because we have the tracks of the cubs as well as... Can't get them there. We can go a little bit further up, Dave. I'm looking, there's some tracks there as well. I'm not going to try go for Brent circled ones, but maybe somewhere here. There's little cub tracks as well as Karula tracks, and I'm going to jump out and point things out. I'm looking, however, for VM's calipers that he very kindly lent me, because here we have the first opportunity that I have had to measure Karula's cub's tracks. Just bear with me for one moment as I disentangle myself from my earpiece, and then we can go and have a look. What I've got here is a set of calipers that gives us an idea of the different track measurements and sizes. We've been playing around with it for a couple of weeks, measuring the various male tracks out here. Now we have an opportunity to measure the tracks of cubs that we know the exact age of. So Karula's cubs, born on the 2nd of February, it is now nearly the 2nd of June. Wow, time goes really fast. What does that make them? Nearly 4 months old. That happened very quickly. And what it does is it gives us a chance to just have a look here. Now, I know it's tricky for you guys to see in this light. And I say that it's actually quite tricky for me to see in this light. Where are these little baby feet? I know Brent said that he saw them. Aha! Is this a little bit too close, Dave? I think you got that one. These are her baby's feet, and because she's walked up and down, they are a little bit obscured. And I'm going to just measure them. I don't know whether which particular cub this is, but we've got an opportunity to measure them. I know it's really difficult, but I don't want to mess them up just yet, so bear with me. I'll draw the outline or trace the outline for you in a moment. So here's a little Karula cub track. Oh, they are so tiny. So, the front track of her cub is... No, sorry, that's the back pad that's obscuring it. There we go, that's a bit more accurate. is 5.7 centimeters. And that is the front right, by the looks of things. Actually quite difficult to tell. The back track of the little cub is 6.4. So really tiny. To compare to Mom's tracks, just to give you a rough idea, Mom's track, let's find a good example, is, this will probably be the best. They, unfortunately, they're a little bit degraded. And what's interesting as well is that she's paced up and down, which means she could be either in this block or in this block, but we'll get back to that in a moment. Mom's track is, for comparison size, front track is 9.3 in this substrate, and her back track, let's find a clearer one, because these are not, oh, there's just tracks everywhere. It's so hard to see exactly where it is. Let us try and find a back right of hers. It's just leopard prints everywhere. But let's just take a quick backtrack measurement just for comparison's sake. Is 9.2. All right, so we've got a bit of a comparison in terms of cub feet sizes, and it's always, they're kind of like puppies. Their feet are always much, much bigger than you expect them to be. So the track that we were measuring and the track that we were looking at, to make it a bit clearer for you, because I know it's not very clear, is this here. Little back track, little back pad. Try and trace it out for you. And there's their little toes. And then the little, tiny little toes of the back track are here. Maybe even a clearer example are these little feet. Oh, adorable. This is a smaller track. I'm going to measure another one just because this is so much fun. This is even a smaller track. This might be the female cub, perhaps. And a slightly smaller one. No, not that far off. 6.4 for back and 5.9 for front. I can hear things moving around me. I have sudden images of Karuna with her cubs being right behind me, which I'd prefer to avoid, if at all possible. And one last, just bear with me one second. I just want to see which tracks are on top of which direction the freshest tracks are going in. Oh, for goodness sake, step in the same place, please. Okay, is that way. They are going that way. It's been tricky to try and see which was the last direction if they don't sort of fall on top of each other. Right. Where has Karula taken her cubs to? That is just a nice little opportunity to look for a direction and also to measure the different paw prints. So she paced up and down last night, obviously probably with her nose a little bit out of joint at the fact that, first of all, her cubs had been disturbed from their hiding place, and second of all that she'd lost her kill to the hyenas, and then had a male lion sniffing around at the same time. I don't think she would have been terribly impressed with that. So now that gives, I mean, Brent has described to me where he last had tracks. He's very clearly seen those tracks before, but now I understand the general trajectory of where she was going. Leopards, unless they're hunting, We often walk with a sense of purpose. In other words, they pick a relatively straight line, although Karula seems to be the exception to that rule. And a comfort for all of you who are watching, these little tracks, there's definitely two sets of cubs. There's two sets of cub tracks. Both of the cubs made it out of that situation unharmed. And Karula knows what she's doing. And at this age now, the worst, the sort of the most dangerous time of the cubs' lives is this, it's first, their first year of life. But then at the same time, the first few weeks are the most critical, the most dangerous, because that is when they are unable to climb trees and they're basically almost defenseless against predators. In she went, straight towards the hyena den. I'm sure Brent has checked around there. I will do one last loop and just see if she hasn't popped out. I'm sure she's just found a nice, safe hiding place. Between this road and the next, there's almost a triangle of roads here. And throughout that, there's a series of drainage lines and dips that crisscross throughout it. And that is a perfect leopard hiding spot. That is exactly where she's gone. And I actually have a hunch, not a suspicion, it's a hunch, as to exactly where she might be. There's a little pool of water, not that far into that block. Oh no, hold on, that's a bit further towards quarantine. It's not impossible. There's a surprise patch of water deep in the block there, away from any of the roads. And there's a nice big jackalberry tree, a really safe spot for her to hide her babies. And I'm gonna try and double check there, see if she's not hanging about. There's some dwarf mongoose on this termite mound, but they are very far away and they're being quite skittish. These winter months. Oh, there we go. Hello. Good morning. Are you planning on going on out foraging anytime soon? Of course, moving from burrow to burrow and from safety area to safety area is to make sure that they have a bolt hole should anything threaten. Also taking regular opportunities to bask in the sunlight. There's a huge feather there. Okay, distraction from the dwarf mongoose. I'm just going to go and grab that feather. Let's see if we can figure out whose feather this is. Yo, look at the size of that. That is one serious flight feather. Ooh, any guesses? I've got a few, and I think it might be. Just wanted to check in along the edge here to see if the feathers on this side are fringed, which would immediately make it an owl. In other words, they've got little slits that break up the flow of the air and essentially make the flight of an owl more silent. But it doesn't look that way. And I mean, this has very clearly fallen out naturally. This hasn't been plucked out. It hasn't been any way been damaged. Sometimes feathers do just fall out, like our hair falls out. You can even see that actually looks like the line where that feather was embedded in the wing. and slowly worked its way out. That seems ridiculously deep, though, surely not. Although I suppose, to hold a flight feather like that, and the forces that it's under, having that much sort of security kind of does make sense. Birds and their wings are just the most incredible things. Really, truly, the aerial adaptations and the way in which the shape of a feather and the shape of a wing provides lift, just like an aeroplane wing, essentially redirecting the airflow so that there's less pressure on top than there is underneath, and it pushes up underneath the bird and keeps it aloft. And you can see how a bird with a feather this size would be adapted for soaring. And I can actually almost I can feel the resistance now just with a slight breeze. I'm not holding this feather up at all. The wind was doing all of the work. And cool. I think I'm going to keep this. We were speaking before about the illegality of certain feathers and how the fact that in the US, only the Native Americans apparently are allowed to keep the feathers of certain eagles. It is not the same here, and we are allowed to keep whatever feathers we can find. I wouldn't be taking it outside of the game reserve. But I think I'm going to keep that one because it's quite spectacular. Important to remember though, that feathers are not clean things. There's probably plenty of mites and parasites on this particular feather. Spectacular though, I mean it's absolutely enormous. And I think, I'm not sure if you all agree with me, but I think that probably came from a vulture. Maybe a martial eagle, but this is a big bird that fell from. And it's very clearly a primary flight feather. Lo and behold, Brent has arrived at Cheetah Plains. He has gone through the bad signal dips, so let's see if he's found anything there yet.
So we've found a big breeding herd of buffalo. Well, we're not sure how big the herd is just yet. They're in this really thick area up in the Combretum Crests, but you can see there's females, and we could be right on the edge. We get some really big herds, and as the dry season progresses, sometimes the herds are going to join together. And we did see one of a group of buffalo about over 500 not too long ago. Okay, look at that. That's a female, and you can see she doesn't have a prominent boss like a male does. And a male has a big, thick layer of matted hair. So their horns are made up of hair. Keratin is the actual substance. So exactly the same sort of chemical compound as our hair are those horns. It's just in a different format, and it is incredible. I just want to move along a little bit, see how many more buffalo are here. Trying to just figure out how many buffalo are here. This could be a small herd, but also they're often split by lines, so they can be separated. There we go. Hello, buffaloes. I haven't seen any tiny ones yet. I think this is quite a small herd. Normally, if it's a really big herd, you can hear them making all the noise. Burr, burr. Okay, let's have a look. So they're going to move off into the thickets a little bit here. And not a particularly big group, but I think we might find some bigger groups as we head towards the Cheetah Plains pad. And, oh wait, there's quite a nice shot of that young bull on the termite mound. Very curved horns on that individual. Oh, no, he doesn't want to be. So they're a bit nervous. They could have been chased by lions. That's why they're in such a small group. Let me just try to roll forward a little bit. There's another cow sitting nicely up on the termite mound. There's that young bull with the very curved horns. I'm trying to roll. Don't I'm gonna have to stop the car. And there we go. There's a younger buffalo there as well. Now with its back towards us. Probably just under 2 years old. So buffalo are predominantly grazers, so they normally only eat grass, but because we're in a drought this year, they will browse as well. So they will eat leaves, particularly of round leaf teak. That seems to be one that they favor in drought times. The moment she's found a bit of chlorus grass on that termite mound and taking full advantage of it. So even though it might look dead and dry, there's obviously still some nutrients right at the base there, and that's what that buffalo is trying to get at. But they're still looking quite healthy. Well, a big Safari Live welcome to Nock, a brand new viewer. And great to have you on the back. And Nock would like to know, do the buffalo ever approach the vehicle? Sometimes they do. If we park, sometimes the herd will just walk around us. But normally if we try not force them to approach our vehicles, but they can approach the vehicles. Generally in the herds, they tend to be a little bit nervous and they'll move away if they can. This is not a very big herd, probably only 30 or 40 animals here. So I'm hoping we will find a big herd, a couple of hundred, and those are always quite spectacular in the amount of noise and dust they produce. But I'm just going to let the other game drives know about the buffalo. So I'll be with you in a sec. There's a small shambi of Nyari on Ingwe Road, just to the west of Junction. So Dave in Toronto said he's heard giraffe. Oh, I'm quite curious of people on walking safaris. Are there any other animals that might be interested or curious about? Oh, it's a little diker. Now quite often as soon as you put the camera on them and they realize they've been spotted, they trot off. There's a little female gray diker. Now diker is a derivative of a Dutch word, diker, a diver basically. They seem to dive into the bush to try to get away from predators. And that's a little female. Not the easiest animals to film often. They quite often disappear into the thickets before you can get a good view of them. Okay, so back to Joe's question. Certain animals will get quite curious, and another one you don't really want to be too curious is buffalo bulls might start walking towards you to have a closer look, but not that common. Generally, giraffe, I would say, are the most curious of you on walking safaris. This is also a good spot to look for in Kayanini. That is the dominant female leopard of Cheetah Plains. She's got two cubs that are a bit older. But because it's so dry at the moment, it's always a good idea to check the water holes. And that's where we're heading to next. Now, three in a row, Pan's been dry for a while. And I'm just going to go do a swing past it. And even though it's dry, this is a favorite area of a favorite leopard of all of ours, a young male leopard by the name of Quarantine. It's one of those. With the afternoon being so cool, I mean only 20 degrees Celsius, there's a chance that a lot of stuff might be moving a little bit earlier. So I'm constantly checking out around us as well as watching for tracks on the road. Last time I saw that young male leopard, Quarantine, was sleeping in a tree right up ahead here at Three in a Row Pan. Now there's a couple of different reasons leopards will be in trees while they don't have meat in the tree, and one of them is to get away from biting flies and insects, and the other is to get away from the heat. It's slightly cooler up in the tree with a bit of a breeze, but it looks like there's nothing at Three in a Row Pan today. So while we continue on towards the Cheetah Plains Pan to see what's there, let's go have a look what Jamie's up to.
nearly caught me out with a mouthful of grapefruit that Dave somehow managed to find. I didn't even know that we had grapefruit, but apparently we do. I'm just going to try and swallow the rest of that bite quickly. Important to keep one's energy up on game drive. Luckily for us, the cameraman very often brings snacks along. Thank you, Dave. Right. Still no sign of Karula in this direction, but I forgot, I don't think Brent has mentioned this to you yet. In fact, I don't even think Brent knows, because Brent went out a little bit earlier this afternoon than I did. So I've got a very nice surprise for some of you, most of you, I'm sure. And that is the fact that just as I was pulling out of the driveway, I happened to catch a glimpse of James Hendry busy unpacking his car after his holiday. Oh. Happy news for all of you. James is back. I doubt he will be on the Sunrise Safari because he's actually back a day early. He will probably be back for his first drive on the Sunset Safari tomorrow afternoon. So for those of you whose hearts have been somewhat broken by his extended absence, he has returned, never fear. And I'm sure he's looking forward to joining you all on drive once again tomorrow. That is exciting news. I didn't even get to say hello to him, actually. I just saw the top of his head disappearing into camp. Carrying a very large tripod as part of James Hendry Media Productions. But James has indeed returned. Also means that Kirsty will be back and Brian should be back soon as well. Some returning staff members that have been greatly missed. a very good afternoon to Chitra, watching in India. Chitra's been joining us very regularly over the last few drives. You wanted to know what measures are taken out here in terms of anti-poaching in the park. The truth is, first of all, I'm not privy to the entirety of that information, and then second of all, unfortunately, it's not something that I would share in any great detail, just in terms of security reasons. But suffice to say, Chitra, there are extended measures in terms of keeping us, or at least keeping all of the animals in this area, as safe as humanly possible from the poaching crisis that has South Africa in its cast iron grip. The rhino, of course, being the most at risk, but all of the animals are potentially at risk. I can safely tell you that the efforts this year have been incredibly successful. And sort of common knowledge is that we have a curfew at night. In other words, we have to be home before a certain time every evening, then whether or not you're visiting some friends somewhere or you are heading out to a gathering of the various guides, you all have to be home by a certain time, so that the poor anti-poaching team doesn't have to run around following vehicles driving in the middle of the night only to find a group of very merry people on their way home from a party. That is one of the measures. Beyond that, I will tell you that the fences, gates, all very regularly maintained and cared for, but I cannot tell you much beyond that. We do see, and I have shown them on drive before at a distance, there are helicopters that fly over the Sabi Sands and the Kruger National Park to help to monitor what's happening. And of course, eyes in the sky, a very important way of covering ground. When you think about it, there's 4 million hectares of area, the Sabi Sands, over 60,000 hectares of wilderness area. That is a lot of space. There's a lot of hiding places, and the team works, teams, however you want to phrase it, work exceptionally hard at keeping our rhino and other animals safe from harm. Something that we are incredibly grateful for, and a job that is not an easy one by any means. But I'm sorry, unfortunately, more than that, I cannot and obviously will not share, just because you never know who might be watching, just for the same reason that we do not show rhino on these live safaris. We don't want to make things any easier for any of the poachers. It is also a statement against the poaching crisis that we have at the moment. This funny feeling that she isn't that far from where those tracks are. I don't know why I feel that way. It might prove to be entirely incorrect. I think it's just the fact that they went off the road so quickly. Just don't think that she's gone terribly far. Fortunately, though, the evidence has not yet served to back me up on that, because I haven't seen hide nor hair of her. The difficulty is, even in winter, where we can see so far into the bush, we actually can't. I mean, the chances of spotting a leopard at 50 meters if she's lying down in the shade behind a tree, exceptionally difficult. And I've come full circuit. I've checked this entire boundary of the block. We're right up close to where we last had those tracks. We've just done a loop around there. Next step, I think, would be to walk through the drainage line system of this block. I know that Brent said he was trying this morning, but that he kept on bumping into various elephant herds. What I can see at the moment, I haven't seen any signs of elephants, so they might have moved out of the area, which might make things a bit easier. And the wonderful thing about Karula is that she's actually a pleasure to walk on foot. She's very, very relaxed. It doesn't scare her, and therefore, because the cubs take their behavior from their mother, It won't scare the cubs either. As we continue to look for her, we're going to soar through the skies from the western edge of Juma right across to the southeastern portion of our traverse area that is Cheetah Plains.
So we've reached the vast open areas of Cheetah Plains, and Viam and I were just having a chat, and we've decided to put a challenge down to ourselves and to you at home. Now, there are only about 20 odd large mammal species in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. So we're not including all the little mice and things like that. So I think we'll, what should we call the cutoff line, Viam? A squirrel? Squirrel, dwarf mongoose actually, dwarf mongoose. So our challenge is to see how many of that 22, 23 mammal species we can put on camera on this sunset safari. So we've got so far waterbuck, elephant, duiker, and buffalo. So we got four, and I'm sure we can do better than that. So let's see how many mammal species we can get. And maybe, should we challenge the other vehicle, Viam? What do you guys think? Should we challenge the other vehicle? If you would like Jamie and I to have a mammal species competition, who can get the most different mammal species on tonight's sunset safari? Let us know if you think we should have a little friendly wager between the vehicles. And you can let us know if you think that's a good idea by sending us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So I'm checking the far northeastern corner of Cheetah Plains at the moment. The only place we've seen in Kanyanini, the dominant female leopard, and we saw her and her two cubs around here. So hopefully a bit of luck. And actually not too far from here is where we saw a pangolin as well. But definitely gonna have to have a squiz over there, see if there's a chance at seeing a pangolin again. If you do see one in an area, it isn't that uncommon to see them again in that area. And especially with this very dry weather we're having, not a lot of grass cover for them to hide in. So fingers crossed. I think Jamie's a bit of an advantage being on Juma. Slightly more general game there, but Viam and I, we like a challenge. This is one of my favorite areas in Cheetah Plains. And if we have a quick look at it, and just from the soil color, you can see it's quite different from most of the areas we get to drive. And then if we look at the trees around as well, slightly different. There's some very big knob thorns and some very big acacias. And also even the sickle bush, which is what GM's showing you at the moment, are quite big, those little ones in front. But very, very beautiful. This massive knob thorn off to the right, a really massive tree. And then also some jackalberries there and coming up, and all growing not on termite mounds or on river or on riverbeds. And that's the soil here. There's a little bit of a reddish tint to the soil, so quite nutrient rich soil. And it's very, very few places in this part of the Sabi Sands where we have areas like this. And it is quite wonderful. I do enjoy driving here. What is that in the shade there? Is that a stick cat or a cat? So unfortunately, I'm in a little bit of a dip here where my comms are a little bit bad, and I know we've got a question from Andreen. Andreen, I can't hear what your question is just yet. Just let me get up onto the high ground on the other side, and then I'll be able to hear it. We're about as far from final control as you get, and when we dip into this little area around Buff Pan, which is this area here, we do have a little bit of comms breakup, but it is very short-lived, and in two shakes of a lamb's tail, we'll be back in comms. So I will let you know as soon as I can hear again. And we are coming up to the area where we spotted the pangolin. So Vim, let's have a look. Although Vim says he'd rather see a cheetah than a pangolin. Well, I think I'd rather see... Vim spotted. I don't even know where Vim's looking. Oh, well spotted Vim. Not a creature we see too often, and not a mammal. It's a secretary bird. Now they're normally in pairs, so it's always good to just check carefully. The other one might be around. Now this is an incredible raptor. It's probably the strangest looking raptor we get. Incredibly tall, about 1.5 meters to 1.6 meters tall. Now they are great fans of snakes, and it's one of their favorite foods, but also lizards, small rodents, and anything it can stomp to death with those long legs. Let's try and get a little bit closer. So I'm going to go try get up to that quarry bush over there, and then we'll stop. I think there's two. There's a pair. Oh, I don't know. Let's just get a safety from back here. It looks like the one is lying down having a snooze. There we go. A pair of secretary birds. Look at that. This is only my third sighting of secretary birds on the live drives. Okay, so they're moving a bit. We're going to go a little bit closer again. Isn't that awesome? So they pace. They do most of their hunting on foot, and they walk through the grasslands and looking for something to stomp on and eat. They generally nest in big acacia trees, generally the tortoise, which has got a big flat crown, and they build their nest right on top. They have a lot of thorny defense of any predator trying to get to their chicks. The second tallest bird we get here, after the ostrich, of course. Quite difficult to tell which is male and female. As you can see, they look very, very similar. That. You can see, as it lifts its feet, you can see there's some serious talons there. Oh, look at this! Off it goes! Whoop! Landing on top of what looks like, yes, a green thorn. Isn't that just beautiful? They're very nomadic birds, although they do tend to return to the same nesting sites year after year, but generally quite nomadic, as I was saying. They've even been known to eat baby tortoises and eat them whole, shell and all. And they do have territories, and as I said, they're quite nomadic in those territories. And the territories can be massive, about 20,000 hectares per pair. And they are monogamous, but in Kruger, the average home range for a pair of secretary birds is around 20,000 hectares. But in other areas, especially the more arid areas, can range up to 200,000 hectares for a pair. Isn't that incredible? That's a massive piece of land. So we are sitting high enough now that we can hear from the final control. So Debbie in Vancouver is wondering, are secretary birds going to be challenged to find food in this cold winter? Yes and no. And there's less sort of insect prey around, which they're not too interested in. So what this weather does is it does bring out a lot of the reptiles to bask, which does make it a little bit easier for them to find that specific prey. And without a lot of grass cover, any rodent that's not in a hole in the ground during the day is easily found. And that goes the same for little tortoises. It's not too much places to hide when the grass is this short. And even sometimes they'll stamp around a hole trying to entice whatever's in it to run out. So one of the very cool things, as I said, one of their favorite foods is snakes, and their Latin name is Sagittarius serpentarius. So due to their fondness of snakes, the second half of their Latin name refers to the snake eater, serpentarius. Well, that one's just having a nice bask in the late afternoon sun. The others moved off foraging. We will come back to this area a little later and see what they're up to. But I think we're going to continue on our little escapade. We're head towards the Kruger National Park boundary. And as I'm sure you've been told by us yesterday and today, well, tomorrow is the Kruger National Park's 90th birthday. So we might have to come visit the boundary again tomorrow to say happy birthday to the Kruger. So where we are in the Sabi Sands is considered to be part of the Greater Kruger, which is the private reserves and some provincial reserves that border the Kruger that there's no fence between. So Andreen, I can hear your question now. Andreen said she's been looking at the maps, and how long does it take us to drive from our camp to Cheetah Plains? Well, it depends, Andreen. We don't normally sort of shoot straight there. We sort of meander and stop and look at things on the way. So normally I'd say this afternoon, how long? We're in half an hour? 25 minutes. But if we're in a rush, probably 20 minutes if we're not stopping and fiddling around. But I mean, it can take us anything from 20 minutes to an hour, depending on what you see on the way. So I want to redub this little corner of Cheetah Plains, Pangolin Corner. So this is where we spotted that pangolin. Dave spotted that pangolin. Also her favorite hangouts have been Canyon Inn. He and her cubs is in this little dry river system here. Although I personally have never seen her here, I've heard before we had our Travis, she spent a lot of time here. She does go into Kruger frequently, taking those little cubs with her. Now, also, it's a road utilized quite often. What was that? Did we get snorted at for him?
I don't yet.
Sounded like a wildebeest snort. Let's go a bit further and have a look. So it's also an area where we frequently find cheetah tracks as they move up and down here. So this part of the Kruger and of the Sabi Sands is quite a bit more open than Juma. And as you can see, that's why we get species like secretary birds and cheetah more often. Now, this is where we saw the pangolin scuttle across the road. Come on, pangolin, make another appearance. Oh, maybe not today. We always like to check the Kruger boundary, see what's been moving to and from. Of course, it's a boundary for us, but not a boundary for the animals. And they are able to move at will. So I haven't heard, has Jamie accepted our little challenge yet? Or is she too scared? You can see what I'm talking about, the more open areas all around us here. So better for certain species. Oh, they're mating. It looks like it, or am I being mad? Is that two secretary birds on top of each other? No. No, they were just standing back to back. It looked like they were mating for a second there. Well, there they are, both on top of the tree now. Look at that. It looks like it's a bit precarious up there on top of the green thorn. A two-headed secretary bird with three legs. Isn't that cool? So I said they're monogamous, so they mate for life. Oh, well, it looks like they might roost here for the evening. So, Ashley's wondering if they migrate. Well, they have local migrations, Ashley. In this part of the world, they have a home range of about 20,000 hectares with a core territory of about 8. But in certain areas like Namibia, they have home ranges of up to 200,000 hectares. So they don't migrate, but they do have very large home ranges that they move through depending on the time of the year and where the food availability will be. So they are not migratory birds, but they can fly for much longer distances than you would expect. So Chitra from India is wondering about a secretary bird's parental skills. Well, very similar to other birds, they generally choose Acacia tortilis, which is sometimes called the flat-crowned acacia or an umbrella thorn to nest on. They've got lots of big white thorns. They nest right on top. Also green thorns that they were resting on there. So they choose trees that have got a big thorny defense to try to stop any parents coming through, predators coming through, but of course they still do have mortalities to snakes and things like that, but they will bring food back to the nest, so very similar to most other birds. Come on, Vim, spot us some cheetah tracks. So Rachel's wondering what is the purpose of, what could the evolutionary purpose of those secretary birds' nice head feathers be? Well, not almost, everything in evolution is driven by two things, Rachel. Sorry, I'm trying to keep a sharp lookout for cheetah tracks while we go down here. And it's either for mating or for food. Now, an adornment like that, something that looks pretty or stands out, means it would have been evolved to attract mates. So it's more than likely that nice frilly hairdo is to attract members of the opposite sex. Now, if you look at a secretary bird's long legs, the evolutionary reason for that is to kick things. So it's for food. So almost everything in evolution is either for food or mating, and pretty much sums up even with human beings. And sounds a bit weird, but it is true. And a lot of things and everything does is to either pass on the genetic code and to stay well fed. No tracks yet, Fiam. I see just some buffalo tracks, nothing fresh though. So Mike is wondering, are Cory bustards much larger than the secretary birds? They're not nearly as tall, Mike, but they're much heavier, so much more thickly built. And as you know, I'm sure a lot of you out there will know, the Cory bustard is the heaviest flying bird in the world. So it's not the tallest flying bird, but the heaviest. I'm trying to remember an exact weight on them. I'll get it for you. Now I'll show you a picture of a Cory bustard for those who don't know what it is. And I heard, I thought Jamie had one of these earlier. She actually had a red-crested Coran. So yeah, that's a Cory bustard. And just check on the weight. Here we go. A male weighs 12.4 kilograms. So that is the heaviest flying bird in the world, the Cory bustard. And you see they theoretically occur here, but their core range, which is the dark green area over there, is further to the east of us on the open grass plains that are below the Lebombo Mountains in the Kruger National Park. So there we go. That's a Cory bustard. Now, I've heard they have seen them on cheetah plains before and in a Buffalo's Hook, but we haven't been that lucky yet. But we've started to get lucky with secretary birds, so who knows what could be on the next open area at cheetah plains. So, the Twitter results are in. 82% say yes to the mammal competition. Vim, you ready? Let's do this. Okay, we're gonna have a tougher time down here, but let's go back to Jamie and see what she has to say about the mammal competition.
Now, I hear tell that I have been involved in a mammal finding competition, whether I want to be or not. Apparently 80% of you are determined that we shall have this mammal finding competition. Now, I have a question. When did this competition start? Because we've seen warthog and we've seen dwarf mongoose. Admittedly, that has been it as far as I know. But we have seen warthog and we have seen dwarf mongoose. So do those count or do they not count? We're going to have to establish some ground rules, because Brent likes to create these competitions and then change the rules to suit whatever circumstances are going his way. Particularly, I'll just remind you, when he has the opportunity to drive Rusty wherever, whereas Wendy at the moment is relatively limited as to where she can drive. But that's okay. That's okay. We can do this. Dave, we have been challenged.
Yes.
And we shall deliver at some point when there is a mammal. Any mammal. Please let there be a mammal. There's no mammals here. No, this is ridiculous. We shall find them. Let's go to... Right, well, Brent's got the great wide open clearings of Cheetah Plains to add to his list. We shall have to go and find clearings of our own. I saw leopard tracks, but they're just old and slightly obscured baboon tracks. Here's a different question. These mammals that we find, does it count if they are obscure? Do you get extra points if it's, you know, a leopard? Or if it is, I don't know, a, a serval or a pangolin. We know that Dave has excellent pangolin spotting skills, or so I'm told. Do we get different points for different mammals, or how is this competition going to work? So I've been walking, I've been wandering about looking for a Karula. Unfortunately, no luck. It's an enormous block. And if I walked past within 50 meters of her and she didn't lift her head up and she was sleeping, there's a good chance I would never have seen her just on foot. So she could well still be there. Unfortunately, my endeavors in tracking, particularly since the soil is quite hard and crispy at the moment off the roads, did not pay off, so we didn't get to put a leopard on your screen. Okay, come on, there must be a mammal here somewhere. We're on two. I've decided we're on two. It started from the beginning of drive. And apparently it is 1 point per animal, mammal, not so no extra points for obscure mammals. We are 1 point for one mammal. Fortunately, at the moment, everything is teeming with mammal life. I feel pressurized. I feel like I need to cover enormous amounts of ground just to find you something. You know, of course, if I lose this, never going to hear the end of it. Although I did win the last mammal competition. I have not forgotten that. Just pipped Brent at the post. We found one more mammal than he did. And Lucy's read my mind. Lucy would like to know when the last time was that I went to the hyena den, which, fingers crossed, would guarantee us at least one mammal. And Lucy, the answer is we double-checked there yesterday morning on the sunrise safari. So yesterday morning, we had that dramatic start with the hyenas and the jackals and the vultures, and the hyena had taken the carcass from the Nkuhumas and dragged it back in what looked like the direction of the den. Unfortunately, nobody was home, and both Brent and myself checked at different times of the day. Nobody was home. However, that shall be my plan for in probably about half an hour or so, as it starts to get a little bit darker. Although the interesting thing about winter, of course, is that the hyena cubs could be active at any time of the day, as long as the adults are around to keep them feeling a bit more secure. You have a much better chance of seeing them out and about. It's not too hot for the adults to be resting close to the drainage line. Aha! Mammal number three. Now, do the mammals have to be different from the one Brent has seen? Or do our impala here count? Okay, so no different. Our impala count, and we're on three. I'm going to go forward a little bit, just to get us a slightly better view. If we're going to look at some mammals, it might as well be a nice view of them. And perhaps they can point me in the direction of some other mammals at the same time. So, warthog, dwarf mongoose, and impala. No? I'm hoping the big male is actually going to come out and maybe even chase the females around, which is why I've stopped here. Difficult view. They found themselves a nice thick patch of vegetation. White fluffy tails wagging furiously. And just the tips of those black highlighted ears. Way of enhancing one of the most important parts of their visual communication. Amazing, this herd on Impala Road. Herds have specific home ranges, that they are, that they move about in, and this, and we're very, very familiar with this particular impala herd. Here's the gentleman at the back who has been guarding this harem furiously, and like all the male impala, looking thoroughly the worse for the wear. I know it was a tricky for you to see, but he's looking a bit battle scarred. And I think, as VM put it perfectly, he suggested yesterday about one of the male impala that it looks as though it had been in a bar fight. Well, they're all looking that way at the moment. Okay, our mammal number three is actually quite obscured in these bushes. And we shall have to continue on. No lingering today. We've got to cover ground. We've got to find mammals. You'll have to stay tuned tomorrow because I have plotted my revenge competition. I don't know if it's a revenge competition. I love a good competition, but I have plotted a competition of my own. But I think I'll put that into practice tomorrow morning on the sunrise safari. Every time I've driven down this road recently, there have been 10 million kudu. That's a slight exaggeration. There have been about 10 kudu living on this road recently. Now they've heard about our mammal competition and they're all hiding, probably laughing at me from behind the trees. Look, I found more mammals, but they're the same mammals. I guess that probably doesn't count. A bachelor herd hanging on the outskirts. These young boys, not tolerated by the larger males, from a range, from an age group of from about 2 until up to 4, which is the age at which they can start competing. These young males get separated off from the rest of the impala and have to settle on the company of other bachelors. Probably suffering the effects of the hormonal rise, but unfortunately not really able to act upon it. They're just not large enough to compete with those big 4-year-old rams with the backwards curving horns. There's something for you to keep on record, since these live safaris do allow us to trace the growth patterns of the different species, since we're out here every day, twice a day. This impala ram is about 2 years old. I sort of fix that picture of its horn growth in your minds as to what a 2-year-old impala looks like. Not this year's babies, but last year's babies. So between 1.5 to 2 years old. But no, he doesn't count towards my total, and therefore we must leave him and see what else we can find. There must be some more mammals along here. And then yes, we shall start heading towards the hyena den to see whether or not anybody's home or if they have moved once again. They've been at that Aubrey's Road den for a long time now. I'm just waiting to see when they're going to decide to move off. And a very big thank you to Michelle in New Jersey. Michelle tells me that 10 minutes ago there were multiple species at the dam. There were kudu, impala and buffalo. So that if our trip along to the hyena den doesn't pay off, then that's another option, another possibility for us. Very much appreciated. Thank you. I shall keep that in mind. Let us see how we go. A bit of a risk, I think, coming up along Sandy Patch. Let's give it a try. Sometimes Sandy Patch can be incredibly productive in terms of mammal life, and this is where the baboon tracks were going as well. We had largely been driven over, which makes me think that they were from very early this morning. Dave, are you keeping your eyes peeled? Where are all the mammal species? They've heard there's a competition involved. Now, apparently one of the animals that has put Brent in the lead, or one of the mammals that has put Brent in the lead, was a grey or a common dacre. And Aaron, you were wondering how far up into Africa the grey dacre or the common dacre spreads. Now, from what I can remember, it is, as its name suggests, one of the most widely spread of the dacre species. And it stretches right up into most of southern Africa, which includes Zimbabwe, Botswana, Namibia, Mozambique, and parts of Zambia as well. I'm just trying to remember if it extends all the way up into Kenya and Tanzania. The interesting thing about the dacre family is just how widely adaptable they are, first of all. It's one of the most widely spread, if you take the family of dacres, one of the most widely spread of widely distributed of all of the antelope tribes. It's technically more correct to describe them as tribes rather than families. The dacre tribe extends exceptionally far north, right up into Africa, right up towards Ethiopia and those regions. But Aaron, I'm just trying to rack my brains. I was reading up on dacres very recently. I'm trying to bring up that picture of the distribution of the grey dacre in my head. Can't remember if it extends much further north. I know that it goes very far up into southern Africa. Dave?
Yes?
Can I have some inside information?
Sure.
Where were those jackal this morning?
I actually worked on a truck.
Oh. That doesn't help. I thought you were with Brent this morning. Sorry. Oh, mammal! I found a mammal! Oh, I found a really wonderful mammal. Hello, little one. You need to come say hello. Would have been a bit embarrassing if I... Run! Panic! Whoops! Would have been a bit embarrassing if I'd missed these mammals, mind you. I think that might have been our snared trunk female. Let me just see if I can go forward a bit. Unfortunately, they, as you could see, very much on the move. That wasn't in response to us. They just want to be elsewhere. Hello, big girl. It is our snared trunk elephant. Hey, wonderful. She's my favorite elephant. Not that we should have favorites, but if we had favorites, she would be mine. The snared trunk female with her very special little family. An almost adult female. A young male. And her brand new little calf. Who's only probably about between 7 to 8 months old. Now, Gracie, on the subject of trunks, and we'll get back to our snared trunk female in a moment. Gracie, who is 8 years old, hello again. You were wondering whether or not an elephant trunk ever falls asleep like our arms and our legs do. That is a really good question, and I've never thought about it before. Generally, when our arms and our legs fall asleep, it's because we've been resting on them in a way that has stopped, not completely stopped, but sort of kind of slowed the blood flow. That's what creates that tingly, funny feeling when we finally get the blood back, and it makes the pins and needles and feels very, very strange. And sometimes you almost don't want to move when you've got those pins and needles because it feels so strange. I'm just trying to think, is there a way, maybe if an elephant was pushing on its trunk for a long time, if it was sleeping on its trunk in a strange way, it might get pins and needles. But honestly, Gracie, I do not know. I think that's a really, really good question. I think it's possible. I think that elephants might get pins and needles in their trunks. Unfortunately, our little, lovely little herd, whilst providing us with another tick for our mammal species, was very much in a hurry to get somewhere. I don't know where they were aiming to get to, but they wanted to get somewhere. I wanted to just explain a little bit. Aha! I thought the jackal might be on this road. Sorry. Just got an update that this is where the jackal were. I just wanted to explain a little bit about our snared trunk female, since she is, I would say that she's one of our main animal characters. I think I have a suspicion as to why our elephants were running like that, and I think it's because there's a big ball somewhere here. We've still got more elephants off to our right, and I'm certain that we're about, at some point we're going to see a big male. And that might be why the females were running off. Hello, guys. We've been so fortunate with elephants recently. This big female guarding the rear of the group, making sure that nobody gets up to any mischief. Hello, girl, what happened to your trunk? She's got a little bit of a cut on the front of her face. Love watching elephants on a I'm not sure you could hear that. It's one of my favorite sounds in the whole wide world. Just that gentleness rumble from deep within the chest of the animal that communicates right across to the rest of the herd and carries through the ground at times. Our elephants are capable of creating frequencies that are actually far lower than our ability to hear them. But in that case, she was communicating to probably the rest of the herd and also to the adult females in the front. So she'll be one of the older, more experienced females walking at the back. And then most, she could be the matriarch. Sometimes the matriarch does choose to walk behind and let other females lead. Or she could be matriarch's sister or cousin, one of a similar, an older group of elephants that will guard the rear and let the matriarch move ahead. Very clearly on a mission. It does make me wonder if there's not a big male here somewhere. Now, the snared trunk female, not really part of any one herd, although she clearly was associating with these other elephants now. And she has lost a third of her trunk, the bottom, obviously the bottom third, makes the only part that makes sense, but she's lost the bottom third of her trunk. And we suspect, we don't know, but we suspect that that might have been due to a snare, that she could have picked up some elsewhere in the park and probably very long ago. Highly unlikely that she was snared in the Sabi sands, very, very carefully looked after and checked for things like bushmeat snares. However, I think that it's all pure conjecture in terms of her background, but I suspect that because it slowed her feeding down, it eventually got to the point where she lost her original herd, but it hasn't in any way impeded her growth or her development. So she came into estrus naturally and created her own little herd of her own. And we still don't know if the oldest female in
BM and I have been checking the far westers of Cheetah Plains, and it's not an area we go into often. Sometimes we have bad signal in this area, but we're checking for leopard at the moment. We found some female leopard tracks just back there, but unfortunately they went into Mala Mala. So I'm just hoping that Tundi could still be in this area. So there's two different females. There's Tundi's independent cub, who doesn't have a name, but she spends most of her time further to the south, and Tundi in this area. So it's difficult to say if those tracks were Tundi's or her cubs. So I'm just checking again carefully around here. It's always nice to go to an area you don't spend a lot of time in, quite exciting. And you can see not many vehicles drive here at all. Lots of elephant activity. And I wonder how many species Jamie's on now. What do you think, Fiam? Think she's overtaken us?
Not yet.
I don't know, I think she might. She might have. So, according to final control, we're both on 4, but Vim, I think we're on 5.
Okay, let's do an audit.
Let's do an audit. Yes, I like that. We had waterbuck, buffalo, duiker, elephant. Oh, I think I was thinking about the secretary birds. Those are not a mammal. So, yes, 4 all. Sure. I have to up our game a bit, Vim. Well, we've been checking this far off western reach region of Cheetah Plains, and I think we've let Jamie do enough catching up. So I think we're going to try our head towards an area where it could be a bit more general game about. And number 5, disappearing across the dry water hole there. Go. Male impala, he is not looking too well. He's obviously been in a fight, and also has flies and ticks all around his face. What did you hear or see, Mr. Impala? Or you're just being cautious? Just being cautious. Okay, so let's continue on. There's number 5 for us. Vim, what do you think our next animal is going to be?
Leopard.
A leopard. I love Vim's optimism. So, hi Tom. Tom is in the great state of Texas and in Dallas. And Tom says he understands the boundaries between the private reserves, but why would Kruger be off limits? Well, outside of the private concessions in Kruger and the public roads, there are vast swathes of land that are left completely undisturbed, with the odd management or firebreak road through there, but no access to the public. And to most of even the staff in the Kruger, and these are called wilderness areas, and they're left just alone to make sure there are places where the animals are so wild they've never seen a car or a person. So that is why, and of course Kruger is under a different management to the private reserve, so they will close it off, and Kruger has different mandates to the private reserves, so there's things are done slightly differently, let's just say that. Yeah, now we're searching for another species. So, hello, James Bear. James Bear says, when we return to Juma, and I'm guessing not when we return from Cheetah Plains, but when we return from our leaves, do we pass through some kind of checkpoint? Do we have credentials? James, we go through the Gowrie Gate, and if you live inside the reserve like we do have a staff card that enables us to pass through the gate. If you do not live in the reserve, you have to be on a computerized list of people arriving that day and pay an entrance fee. That entrance fee goes towards helping anti-poaching. So those are for the visitors coming into the reserve. For the rest of us, who live here, we do have little staff cards that enable us to pass in and out of the gate. Well, hello, John Patrick, who's 10 years old and from Mississippi. And you eat lots of catfish down there, John Patrick. Well, John Patrick stumped me. I will admit to being stumped. And John Patrick would like to know how many people visit the park every year. And for the Sabi Sands, I could not tell you, John Patrick. I can guess a couple of thousand, maybe. Trying to work out beds, numbers, lodges, occupancy rates. 10,000, maybe? Maybe a few more? I think Kruger, I do know, gets 1.6 million visitors a year. That is incredible. 1.6 million people go to the Kruger National Park every year. Amazing. Okay, so we have literally circumnavigated Cheetah Plains, and we have not had any luck with the kitty cats, or actually very little apart from an impala, a duiker, and some buffalo. Now, even Gnomeless Gnomon was missing today. And I'm going to start slowly making my way back to the west, seeing if we find something on our way. Always check for tracks at the junctions of roads. So, unfortunately, Jamie's got some gremlins and they're trying to sort it out at the moment. So, yeah, with VM and I for now, as we explore the western sectors of Cheetah Plains, and not a part of the reserve we go to too often. So always exciting to explore a new area. And there's a wonderful little dry river system that runs parallel to this road that I'm hoping will produce us our sixth species. And VM has predicted it to be a leopard. I love his optimism, I'm not so sure myself. I think it could be a steenbok. Long-tailed shrikes flying over. So, James Richard is wondering, of the bird species found in the area, which one would be considered young on an evolutionary scale? That is quite an impressive question there, James. And I'm going to have to get back to you on that one. I'm going to have to do a bit of research and speak to some of my ornithological friends. And they might know the answer to that. If I had to say something, I'd just be guessing. And I don't want to be doing that. I'd rather have my ducks in a row. Maybe you guys out there can give me a hand. You have access to the interwebs, or the internet. So what of the bird families in Southern Africa would be considered the youngest? Now, James, I can't answer the birds, but I can answer the mammals. And probably the youngest mammal species around here is us. And after us would be Inyala. So Inyala is a relatively new species. Okay, so we're going to check the opposite side of that dry water hole we saw that male impala in, just in case he wasn't being paranoid and there might have been something on the other side. And the main reason I'm actually coming to check down here, although unfortunately I've just heard they have already been found, is that this is the one part of Cheetah Plains that the Styx females bring those little cubs, but it seems like they are further to the southwest. Hi, Ashley. Ashley is in Missouri. Ashley would like to know if I've ever found any artifacts in the Sabi Sands. I have indeed, Ashley. I found, actually, Steph and I on bushwalk last week found the remnants of a grinding stone that would have been used to grind maize and sorghum and millet. And I found quite a lot of stone tools and pottery closer to the Sand River, though. The stone tools and pottery. This area here would have traditionally been used very seasonally. So people would have moved up, depending on the time of the year, away from the permanent waters of the rivers to harvest marula fruits or ivory fruits or wood, or collect quartz or other rocks from the Korpis out this towards the Manuleti. But it wouldn't really have been any permanent habituation of people in this area up until about 100 years ago. As you can see, lots of great questions coming through, and as I said, we'll always do our best to give you the best possible answer, but sometimes you guys do stump us. But if someone out there has just sort of stumbled upon us, is wondering how the questions are getting to us, you can drop us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Send through your question and Jamie and I will do our best to answer them for you. We do try to get through everyone's questions, but unfortunately sometimes that's not possible. So don't get despondent and keep sending those questions. Donovan. Donovan is from Secunda, South Africa, and he's 8 years old. And Donovan's asked me a very interesting question. He'd like to know what is the fourth biggest cat species in the Greater Kruger National Park. We know number one is the lion, number two is the leopard, three is the cheetah. Even though the cheetah is taller than a leopard is heavier, therefore bigger. And number four, Vim?
Caracal?
Yes, spot on. It is the caracal. So serval are taller than a caracal, but they are, caracal are much heavier, much bigger animals. So caracal is the fourth, serval is the fifth, and African wildcat is the sixth. And those are the six species of, cats that occur in the Greater Kruger National Park. Now, on the live drives, I think we've managed to get between all of us everyone except caracal. Caracal's missing. So hopefully during this dry season we'll be able to get you a caracal as well. But really great question, Donovan. And we've got the sun dipping below the western horizon. So apparently, before my time, a caracal was seen with Peter Pretorius live. So there we go. All of the cat species have been seen. But I hope to find one as well. I think VM would start doing a dance of joy if we found a caracal. Hello, Lucy from South Bend, Indiana. Lucy would like to know, do animals change their behavior depending on the time of the year and how? Well, Lucy, it depends. Certain species, yes, all of them, yes. But very, very minimal. I mean, a lot of it's going to be focused on food and water. So, especially on a drought year, you're going to get a lot more stress, especially in animals like buffalo and elephant. They need lots of water and lots of food. And they tend to travel bigger distances between those two things. And you will see condition drop on a lot of the animals. Lion, leopard, or the cats or predators are active a little bit earlier in the afternoon and a little bit later in the morning because of the cool. So there's slight differences, but you must remember, the animals can decide to change their mind any moment. We make the rules, not them, and they don't read the books, so they can do whatever they want. I was hoping we'd get something on the pan in front of the lodge at Cheetah Plains. But alas, a barren plain it is. Okay, well, it seems like they've managed to beat those gremlins with a baseball bat. So Jamie's back up and running. Let's go see what she's been up to. And I hope she hasn't found any more animals.
An attack of the gremlins has put me back in our mammal finding competition. Nevertheless, we do have an extraordinary sunset to show you. Might not count as part of our competition, but it does provide us with a really nice, peaceful spot to just sit and enjoy this spectacular blood red of the sunset. Beautiful. Fortunately, we can't sit and watch it set completely because it's a tugging reminder about the fact that we're going to run out of light at the hyena den, which means we're going to miss out on our chance to see them and to, first of all, spend time with one of my favorite animals, and then second of all, of course, risk missing the opportunity to add them to our collection of mammal species. Now I've got sort of bright sun-themed spots in front of my eyes. I'm looking at that spectacular sunset, bright purple spots every time I close them. But we're going to go and see if we can't add a spotted mammal to our mammal competition. Proving to be a tricky afternoon in terms of mammals. They're all playing hide and seek with us, with more hiding and much seeking and less finding. Just by the way, before we disappeared due to the attack of the gremlins, I said that I thought that there would be a big male elephant that was causing the distress there on the ellies, but it doesn't seem to be the case because no big bulls came past us. So if there was one, he wasn't pushing behind the rest of the herd and causing that very determined movement off in a different direction. Okey-dokey. Nobody's home at the first den, which is to be expected at this point. They're hardly ever at the firebreak den. Hopefully they are at the southern Aubrey's Road den. And if they're not, we might have to do a mad race down to the Juma Dam just to help to add to our mammal collection for the afternoon. Oh wow, that's incredible. From the moment that sun dipped below the horizon, instantly felt that change in temperature suddenly become very nippy. Come on, little hyenas. Please be home. And speaking of the setting sun, really interesting question coming from Cecilia. Cecilia, welcome to the Sunset Safari. You were wondering, just in terms of visual comfort, what animals will walk sort of with their back towards a rising or a setting sun in order to be able to see what's ahead of them? Well, Cecilia, that's a really good question because, of course, most of the animals here, or a lot of the herbivore species at least, far more concerned about the wind direction than they are anything else, even if it means that they have to squint. If the wind is blowing from the setting sun or from the rising sun, they'll walk straight in that direction because they're more reliant on their sense of smell. And oh no, Cecilia, I'm going to pop that question on pause for a moment to impart the devastating news that our hyenas are not home. What a pity. Dear, oh dear. Nobody home at the Aubrey's Road Den. Oh no, Dave. Means we don't have one more mammal to add to our list. We'll have to keep going. But Cecilia's question is a really interesting one because, as I said, the herbivores are more reliant on their sense of smell, so they're going to walk into the wind whenever possible so that they can smell a potential threat. The predators, on the other hand, they are a bit more visually based. What I mean by that is that especially that hunting instinct triggered by movement more than anything else. So you could well find that there is a preference of leopards or lions to hunt in a way that they aren't blinded by the glare of the sun. You might even find that an animal might try to stalk from the sun towards a herbivore so as to utilize it as a masking technique in the hunt. Now that's a distinct possibility. I am relatively certain I've used that technique before when approaching certain animals on foot, but only when the wind direction is right. Otherwise, you might as well not bother, since they do have such an incredible sense of smell. Speaking of senses of smells, where did that come from? Oh. Oof. That's part of a carcass that's been brought back somewhere. I can smell it, but I can't see it. Do you see anything on your side, Dave? Somewhere near the base. It smells like rotten meat over here, and it's not hyena scat. Hyena scat is exceptionally smelly, but in this case, that's not what's causing the scent. They don't really defecate around the den site, unless they are very scared or it's in response to basically being submissive to one of the adult females. I smell it, but I don't see it anywhere here. I'm sure, though, that it's part of the buffalo carcass that has been dragged back. The buffalo carcass that the Nkumas killed 3 nights ago and that the hyena nicked from them not last night, but the night before, that we saw them playing with. I'm sure it's here somewhere. I can definitely smell it, but I can't quite see exactly where it is. And obviously I don't want to get out and walk around, especially if the hyena cubs are still home. I don't want to scare them or add my scent right next to the den site unnecessarily. Oh no, behind in the mammal count. Got to catch up I'm not even sure what Brent's total is anymore. I think he was on 5 last I heard, but it might be even more than that by now. We're only on 4. Oh, apparently he's still on 5. Well, that is good news. We've only got 1 to go. We've only got 1 to catch up with him. As the chill starts to set in, Debbie from Vancouver, good afternoon and always welcome to the Sunset Safari. You wanted to know if the animals in winter suffer from any skin conditions or rashes or anything like that. The dryness actually probably helps their skin conditions a little bit, Debbie. A lot of the animals, particularly in summer, the fungal infections and the mange infections can be particularly unpleasant for them. Buffalo, giraffe, they tend to be the ones that suffer most from those sorts of skin conditions, if we describe them as. But the dry, that's often because that warm, moist air is ideal for the propagation of the organisms, the microorganisms that cause those problems within them. Now, the dryness helps a little bit to dry it out. They might get a bit cracked and a bit uncomfortable, but I think infinitely preferable to the wet season feeling, the muggy and the heat, and must be even more uncomfortable then. Not that I'm aware of. I suppose most of us are fortunate we don't suffer from chilblains as people, so I can't think of any skin conditions that any of us get more in the winter than in the summer. But it is a very good point. The conditions, the animals have to be so incredibly widely adaptable for the conditions out here. We're fortunate in that we don't have frozen winters, we don't have frost, we don't ever really dip far below 32 degrees Fahrenheit or 0 centigrade. But they still then have to cope with the extremes, like the summer that we had this previous summer was one of the hottest, in fact the hottest on record. I have never experienced a summer like that, very, very regularly having temperatures well over 100 degrees Fahrenheit each and every single day. And even more unusually, because of the dryness, there was no relief in the form of thunderstorms or anything like that, or rain pouring down. It was one of the most extreme summers I've experienced. And then you add to that sudden shift towards winter and these frigid temperatures, or what feel like frigid temperatures to me. And there's not really a transition period in the South African seasons. We kind of go from winter to summer with a very minimal spring and autumn. We don't really have the typical 4 seasons. It's more that we have a dry season and a wet season, and this year it's just been one massive dry season. We're losing light, Dave. To find them. I'm assuming that as part of this competition, the diurnal animals at night will not be counted, since we can't really put them on camera, we can't spotlight them and light them up. I'm assuming we're going to discount them as part of our total. Just a quick update for you. Speaking of spotlighting and animals at night and so on, I have heard an update through the Game Drive channel that they did find a male lion on Torchwood. I haven't heard yet whether he has, been identified. We'll get back to that in a moment because we have mammal number 5. Don't go, boy. Still counts, even if he's hidden behind the trees. Definitely counts. Tick a kudu off our list. Quite a young male. You can see that clearly from the size of his horns, first of all, and also the thickness of his neck. He hasn't yet reached his full size. Oh, he stopped in exactly the wrong place. I was hoping he might move further forward. Belonging to my favorite tribe of antelope, the Trafalophagus antelope, consisting of the largest antelope in the world, the eland, and then right down to its smallest member of the tribe, which is the bushbuck. And these are definitely, hands down, my favorite antelope to see. From the Nyala to the Kudu to the little really pretty and shy bushbuck. And then if you go further afield into Africa, not that you'll see them here, but the Sitatunga, as well as the bongo. This is a dream of mine to see a bongo in the wild. I've only ever seen them in a zoo before. I'll have to travel much further north into Africa to fulfill that dream. I want to add to the collection of the Trafalagus antelope that I have seen in the wild. And there goes one of its largest members. Kudu bull, still relatively young, moving off. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever seen a picture of, sorry, distraction. I don't know how many of you have ever seen a picture of a bongo before. They are the most incredible antelope. It's kind of like a Nyala. Oh, there we go. Beautiful.
Crossing back from the east. I can't have any updates.
He is beautiful. Starting to get that slightly darker color. And the chevron of white between his eyes. And then the horns, not quite even reaching two twirls yet. Just one and a half twirls. Off he goes. Finishing off our mammal number 5 sighting for the afternoon. Now, what I was saying earlier was, I don't know how many of you have ever seen pictures of a bongo. Unfortunately, my wildlife book that I have with me doesn't have a picture of one, but I was describing them. They're this deep, rich red color, and like an Nyala, but stockier and a little bit larger. Incredibly beautiful antelope. So that's one of the many things on my wish list of mammals to see throughout Africa. And apparently Brent has very kindly offered to show it to you on his iPad. Just so everybody knows, that definitely doesn't count as mammal number 6 for him. But yes, Brent has offered to show you a picture on his iPad. Now, I was in the middle of giving an update. Now, apparently, I've just heard on the Game Drive channel, it is in fact 2 male lions that were found on Torchwood. Now, this morning, a male lion was seen drinking at the Pan, sort of in the middle of the night last night, along with the 3 Nkuhuma females. After that, I found tracks for the 3 females crossing into Torchwood, which they later found the lions themselves in that area. And the young male was not found. Now, I definitely found tracks of a male with that group of females, but I have no way of knowing if it is the same male lion that was at the dam with them that then walked all the way across into Torchwood. Now, apparently it's actually 2 males that they found on Torchwood, no identity yet. It seems most likely, if there's 2 of them, that it would be 2 Birmingham boys, but impossible for us to know. And we have mammal number 6. Mammal number 6 is playing hard to get. Oh, there we go, there's one that's come out. Ah, I'm just chatting about you lot. The second member of the Trafalagus tribe of antelope, a herd of female Nyala with their tan color, and actually relatively easily to distinguish from that kudu that we saw earlier, even if it is a female kudu without horns, that they have much more vivid striping on their coats, as well as spots that the kudu lack, and the kudu much, much larger than a Nyala. I know that it's difficult to get a sense of scale through the screen, watching through the screen and through the camera. So if I could sort of roughly give you a height, kudu is about, first of all, it's about double the size of a Nyala. A Nyala is probably the height of a, what, that would be a good comparison, a Great Dane maybe? And somewhere there's an elephant as well. You just hear him moving off in the bushes. Yeah, so a Nyala probably the size of a Great Dane in terms of height at least. Maybe a little bit lighter than a Great Dane. And then a kudu will be twice that size, twice that height. They are moving off, and we need to move off the road as well. We're stuck right in the middle of the main road, and there's somebody who would very much like to get past us. It gives me a chance to investigate the source of the noise. Not that it needs much investigating. I could hear branches breaking off behind us. Just moving off the road to make space, and we've got an elephant in the darkness. Looks like a young bull. We have a wonderful question that's come through from Karen on the subject of elephants, and one which I have only recently learnt about. And Karen, you've read something that has told you that an elephant only takes about 5 breaths per minute, and you were wondering what its lung capacity would be. And the answer to that question I actually know now, after I did some research when one of the viewers asked me that a few days ago. An elephant breathes about 310 liters per minute, when compared to roughly the 7 or 8 liters of a human being. So if you divide that by 5 breaths, you will get a rough lung capacity. So 310 divided by 5 is roughly somewhere in the region of about 60 liters, probably between 50 to 70 liters. And here's a fascinating thing about an elephant's lungs, which has been suggested by evolutionary theorists as being, first of all, an adaptation to their incredibly large size. I'm just going to roll forward ever so slightly so we've got a view of his head. There we go. An adaptation to their large size, as well as to a potentially aquatic ancestor. Most animals, most mammals, humans included, have what's known as the pleural space between the membrane of the lungs and the wall of the chest cavity. It's filled with pleural fluid, and that little bit of space just allows for cushioning of the lungs. Elephants do not have that lung capacity. What that means is, that pleural space. What that means is that the walls of their lungs are attached directly to the walls of their chest cavity, and allows them to breathe under high-pressure situations. So that's why an elephant can fully submerge itself in water and still breathe through its trunk like like a human being going snorkeling, despite its enormous size and the amount of pressure that is exerted on it in those situations. It's just one of the things that allows the elephant to compensate for basically having an enormous amount of lung within its body. And that, combined with a massive heart, is what it keeps it going. Part of a fully formed and very well adapted pulmonary circulatory system. Hey, beautiful boy, you couldn't be less concerned with how your breathing works or your heart works. You just want to munch on what actually looks like a raisin bush of some description. Beautiful in this afternoon light, but it is getting a little bit too dark. It's just very peaceful to spend time with elephants in the evening. Hello, boy. Since he has chosen to move behind the trees, I'm going to leave him to his dinner. In the meantime, Brent has made his way back from cheetah clearing, so let's find out how he's feeling about being overtaken in his mammal competition.
So, I heard Jamie is ahead on 6. It's quite disappointing news. We did not see a soul on our way back from Cheetah Plains. So, we have come back to just have a quick squiz around the western parts of Juma. And hopefully we'll find a mammal or three, preferably three. Send us above Jamie. We're on 5 at the moment, if my maths is correct. But maybe we'll find some interesting nocturnal mammals. But before we do that, isn't that just too pretty? The retired knobthorn with that beautiful sky behind it. Just gonna stop for VM in a second. Quintessential African sunset shot. Now, one of the other reasons we're showing you this gorgeous skyline, you can see some lights in the distance outside of the reserve in the foothills of the Drakensberg Mountains there. It's always a good time to listen. It's when the cats are going to start getting moving. And so they might disturb an impala, nyala, or kudu, or they might decide to vocalize. Always a good time. Just take a moment or two, enjoy your scenery, and listen to your surrounds. That half light with the spotlight sort of needed, sort of not. Still can see quite a bit with our eyes, but we are on a time frame to get a few more mammal species. And of course, as it gets darker, that becomes more difficult. Well, hello, John Patrick. Another question from John Patrick, who's 10 years old in Mississippi. Well, John would like to know, how are we safe from a sneaky lion attack? Well, fortunately, they don't like the taste of cars. So they don't really attack cars too much. You really have to annoy a lion to get it to attack a car. It doesn't smell like anything they can eat. It smells like petrol and oil, and or petrol, you guys call it gas, and such. So during the day, oh, hello Impala, you're already on our list. Oh, zebra, just on the edge of our light. Number 6. Ah, there we go, we can just make him out. As I said, there's still quite a bit of ambient light left from the setting sun, but we're not going to hang around after dark with the diurnal animals. Sorry about that, John Patrick. Back to your question. As I'm saying, so during the day, again, in the vehicles, you're completely safe. And even when walking, lions are quite scared of people during the day. We're the dominant predator during the daytime, but at nighttime, it's a very different thing. That's why we don't walk around at night. It's very dangerous because a lion will 90% of the time run away from you during the day, but at night they'll try to eat you. So lions are the dominant nighttime predator and we're the dominant daytime predator. So Joyce from New Hampshire, I didn't catch the end of it. I think Joyce is wondering about the Nkahumas. And if Junior is still with the Nkahumas, he is not. The 4 Nkahuma ladies were found. Oh, there we go, VM number 7 possibly hiding in that hole. Joyce, I will be back with you in a tiny bit. We've just found a bush baby in a hole. He's just ducked back into the hole. But if we sit quietly, he might pop his head up again. I'm just gonna turn the light off for a second and see what happens. That bush baby was about to come out of the hole. So that gives me the perfect opportunity to answer Joyce's question, whether Junior was still with the Nkahuma ladies. He was not. The 4 ladies were found this morning on Torchwood without Junior. Now the 5th lady is obviously still looking after those cubs, as she hasn't introduced to the pride just yet. And I've just heard 2 Birmingham boys have been found in Buffalo's Hook. So if Junior's got any brains at all, he'll be running for the hills. Now, what happens is if Junior wants to survive, he cannot hang around with his natal pride. The Birmingham boys will definitely make short work of him. Also, he's a big danger to those 3 new cubs, to that other Nkahuma lioness. So he's a very big danger. So we don't really want him hanging about. He would definitely kill those cubs. Now, that bush baby is obviously playing peekaboo with us. It hasn't come back up. What do you think, Vim? Do we wait it out?
Let's give him a minute.
Let's give him a minute. Now, sometimes they have multiple holes. That is a perfect little bush baby nest. What I think I'm going to do, Vim, I'm going to reverse a bit further up the road, see if he pops his head out. Okay, I think this should be good. So he's in that terminalia, which is a beautiful tree, one of my favorites out here. And I tend to prefer the sandy soils, and actually they are termite resistant. So used traditionally as fence posts and for building huts. Is that him there? No, shame. I think he's feeling a bit scared. So we'll have to try find another one. Let's just have one last gander as we go past. No other holes? Nope. Okay, let's carry on. Oh, that could have been the winning animal, Vim. We spent a lot of time in this area on the Sunrise Safari looking for Karula. She's somewhere in here, but there's quite a nice little creek system in there. Great place to leave the cubs. Maybe she will leave them there while she heads off hunting. Again, where do you reckon, VM? Zoe's or Rebecca's?
Yeah, Zoe's.
VM's feeling like a serval. And we do see serval and sign of serval quite often on Zoe's road. So I know Jamie's been chatting about an animal she really wants to see, called a bongo. Now, a bongo is a traffic-legged, so it's related to kudu in Nyala, and there are two types of bongo in Africa. There we go, that's a western lowland female bongo. You can see a similar resemblance. It's sort of like a giant in Nyala. That is a female western lowland, and they occur. I have never seen one. It's whoopsie. Well, at least I caught it. So they occur right in the center of the Congo Basin. So where I've worked in the rainforest has been in Congo, but below that, I'm pushing things that I shouldn't push. Oh dear. There we go, okay. And so there we go. So right, let me find something that's better to point with. Oh dear. Anyway, so I was right below that red line in the Congo and to the left of the red area in Gabon. So that is the western lowland bongo. Then there is the eastern mountain bongo, which is really rare and really endangered and lives in a bit of remnant forest in Kenya. So really strange in a mountain range called the Aberdares. And I just want to show you one more picture of a bongo, a male bongo. There we go. Can see quite a bit darker and look, massive horns. I mean, they can weigh 350 kilograms, a massive animal. And definitely something that's on both Jamie and my bucket lists. But speaking of Jamie, let's hope she's not finding any animals and hopefully we'll be back with an animal shortly.
As we race towards the finish line, that is the end of the Sunset Safari. No, I haven't found another mammal. When we are searching high and low, could we pip Brent at the post, desperately looking for one of the mysterious small and nocturnal creatures? Dave would very much like to see a genet. We had a wonderful genet sighting the other night on our way home from Cheetah Plains. And I'm actually returning, I can't quite get to the general area of where we saw it, but I'm trying to, in the vague hope that if we keep our fingers crossed, we might just get to see one. And unfortunately, our signal's too shaky, we have to go back.
So, back with me. Unfortunately, it seems like Jamie's got some gremlins that they need to sort out quickly. So, we're in search of nocturnal creatures, bush babies, civets, white-tailed mongoose and the like. But I don't think I'll ever complete my bucket list of animals and creatures to see in this world. But hopefully, I'll get close. Unfortunately, bongos tend to live in countries that are not the most stable at the moment. One of the best places to see bongos is the Central African Republic, which is heavily unstable at the moment. Not somewhere you really want to travel to. One of the countries on my bucket list that is safe and stable to travel to is Ethiopia. Now, for the mammal species there, you've got the Ethiopian wolf, mountain in Nyala, gelada baboons, and what's the goats called now? There's little mountain goats there as well. They're tars, no? Maybe not. Can't remember just offhand. But the birding in Ethiopia and the cultural and history are absolutely incredible. Come on, animals, where are you hiding? Janet's wondering, do we use mosquito repellent or insect repellent when we go out at night, or tick repellent? Well, fortunately, the ticks we only really get when we're walking. We do use some insect repellent, but normally back at camp or before you go to bed. And we don't really. Most of us don't sleep under mosquito nets. Some people do.
I do.
VM does. I don't. Normally, all you need to keep the mozzies away is a good fan, and they struggle to fly in the wind. But we do use mosquito repellent, but normally in the summer months. In the winter months, we have very few insects or mosquitoes. There are the odd ticks about if you're out on bushwalk, but nothing too major that would cause us to wear any repellent. Although I'm quite lucky, ticks don't seem to like me that much. Jamie and Steph, on the other hand, they seem to like a lot. Vim, do you get bitten much by ticks on bushwalk?
No, almost never.
Almost never. Oh, quickly across to Jamie, who's got another animal. Darn it.
Is it the blackness in the center frame?
I found something, and I don't quite know what it is, so we're going to try and investigate. I think, let me just get a double check here, because I suspect it's just, if we go, right, I've just lost track of where it is, right in the middle of my spotlight between those bushes there, Dave. Oh, is there a scrub hair there? In front. Is that a scrub? No, looks like a scrub here, but it's that's not what I'm looking at, actually. That's a log. I think what I have is a sleeping daca at the back. Now, we're not going to shine our light on it anymore, because I strongly suspect that it is a daca. And I've learned my lesson from the last time this happened, that we're not going to linger for too long. If it were a nocturnal animal, it wouldn't have been so still. I think. And also the eyes are slightly sideways facing, which makes me think immediately some kind of an antelope. There's two, and it is indeed two little sleeping daca. Oh, that kind of counts, doesn't it? I didn't mean to spotlight them. No, that was my rule. Okay, no, it doesn't count. I can't break my own rule. I kept the spotlight on them for a minimal period of time, so they won't be in any way suffering the ill effects of spotlight. But what we don't do is we don't prolong any exposure to the bright light of the spotlight on diurnal animals, daytime animals, just because it interferes a little bit with their night vision. Just like when I was sitting watching the sunset and I said to you that I've got bright spots in front of my eyes, and the same applies for our diurnal creatures out here. We don't spotlight them. And it's an interesting thing, next time you watch a documentary and there's a lion hunt or a leopard hunt, at night, just have a look. Not that all documentaries do this, and there's some very, very ethical documentary makers, but just have a look next time you watch a documentary and see, as that animal is hunting, whether or not there are lights being shone on the antelope or whatever it is that they are hunting. If they're sneaking up on them. And then you can draw your own conclusions from there. We, as you know, take an absolute stance that we interfere as little as possible. We don't want to interfere with the animals at all. It's impossible to say that we don't have an impact in some way on their lives. Just in terms of driving the vehicle around, we do. There is a level of interaction there, but not necessarily negative at all. In fact, I think especially for elephant herds with their youngsters, I think we provide a form of entertainment. That's one of the reasons why I haven't gone back towards Karula or where the last tracks were, even though there's a good chance she's going to be moving around at this point in the evening. I'm not going to go back there just because we, even if we did find her, we wouldn't be spotlighting her young cubs at this, certainly not at this age. We don't want to run the risk of causing them any harm. Now, we haven't even headed back to where those tracks are, despite the fact that I'm sure she's going to pop out there very, very soon. And Magala, you were wondering, because you've just started watching and we spotted those two little antelopes sleeping behind the bush, you're wondering, what is a duika? And the answer is, a duika, spelt D-U-I-K-E-R, is a type of small antelope. It's one of the dwarf antelope species, a very, very tiny little antelope that we very commonly see here. It's grey in colour, it's roughly the size of a, I'm trying to think of a good example of a breed of dog that would be a comparison, about the size or just, Irish Terrier is a little bit too big. A very small Irish Terrier might be a good description, or a very large Fox Terrier, something along those lines, one of the longer legged terrier groups. A small little antelope. The name duika means diver in Afrikaans, and it's descriptive of the way in which a duika runs from predators and dives into the bushes to try and hide away. That's where the name duika comes from. That is a common or a grey duika that we have in this area. We also in South Africa get the red and the blue duika, but we don't see them in this particular areas. In this particular area. Now that's terribly tragic. Brent has found not a log hare, but an actual scrub hare.
There we go. And I think we'll tie now a little scrub hare. Hop, hop, hop. Out on the open areas of quarantine, grazing away. Not going to leave the light on him for too long. There we go. Oh, see how alert they are. Look at those ears moving constantly to try to pick up on any danger. But let's leave him be. Shame, little one. So I think it's all tied. I'm not sure. All tied up. And let's see if we can find another nocturnal beastie to show you before the end of the show. Well, Jamie thinks that nocturnal animals shouldn't be allowed, but they are mammals, and we did say mammals. So, unfortunately, I think they are allowed. And they're harder to find, which is more fun. Let's go have a quick squiz down around the Juma Dam cam. So if far, just picking up the eyes of lots of impala around, but we don't keep the lights on them. If anyone's new and wondering why we don't shine on animals like impala and zebra, so these bright spotlights with their eyes that are designed to be most effective during the daytime, it gives them a slight blinding effect. Not for very long, but it can affect them if there's a predator close by. Whether it's a predator's eyes or nocturnal animal's eyes are very different. So they don't have that same effect when you use the spotlights on them. And that's why we don't shine our lights on the daytime animals. Oh, bush buck. Ha ha, a bush buck ran across the road. We saw it. But there we go, I think that keeps us safe for this evening. But I think maybe we'll continue on this mammal challenge on tomorrow's sunrise safari. But it's been wonderful having you with us. And what an incredible secretary bird sighting. Definitely one of the better ones I've had in the last 5 or 6 years. And it was wonderful to be able to share that with you. But we're going to head home. Hopefully there's a big roaring fire to curl up next to. Definitely regretting wearing short pants on tonight's sunset safari. But, oh, there's some impala running past. But we will see you in a few short hours for the sunrise safari. And James Henry will be back tomorrow to enthrall you and entertain you. And it'll be nice to have him back in camp. But for the last few minutes of drive, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Diurnal animals count, huh? Oh, there we go. Dacre plus buffalo puts me, I believe, at 8. Now obviously I'm not spotlighting him. You can see that the light is right out of his eyes. And he just happened to be in the road as I went right past him. Sorry, boy. Good evening. Have fun. Watch out for lions. Yay! I think we just won, Dave.
Oh, yes.
I think we just won on the basis of Brent changing a rule that I put in place that disadvantaged me. Oh, apparently it is 8-all. It is 8-all. It is a tie, ladies and gentlemen. This evening, despite our best efforts, Brent and I have come out with an even total of the number of mammals that we have seen on this, what I would describe as a relatively quiet but thoroughly enjoyable afternoon safari. As it draws to a close, we'll have to wait and see what the mysteries of the night leave for us in the morning to unfold the various clues as to what happened while we were all safely tucked away in our beds. And you'll just have to stay tuned for the sunrise safari to find out, along with the competition that I have up my sleeve for Brent. Thank you, Dave, for your fantastic camera work, as always, as well as to Rebecca and Louise in final control. And most importantly, thank you to all of you watching across the globe. I hope that you had fun, and I hope that you're looking forward to tomorrow morning's safari. We will catch you there. Bye-bye, everybody.